Just to introduce myself, my name's Owen Espy. I'm the Senior Economic Justice Campaigner at War on One. And I've kind of been very kindly invited to chair this session. I also have the great honour and privilege to be on the board of the Jubilee Debt Campaign and help the incredibly hard-working secretariat there deliver events like this and all of the many different activities that they do. In this session, the way we thought it'd be best to structure it is Sarah's going to kick off with a bit of a kind of global context. What's happening? Where's happening in the global financial markets? What is this lending boom? What is it all about? Then I'll ask Bernard to come in and continue talking to us around the situation in Ghana, how people are affected and there. And then hopefully, before that point, Kofi will arrive. And I will ask him to talk about, to kind of situate this particular crisis within a longer history of struggle, and also focus very much on the City of London and Western government's responsibilities there, as we are here in London today. So without further ado, I'm going to ask Sarah to kick off. I think she's using some PowerPoints to help us get our heads around all of those facts and figures. So I'll hand over to her.
Thank you. Yes, I'm actually going to sit here, I hope that's all right, so you don't need to see me, you just have a big screen. So I think as I mentioned, I mentioned in the opening plenary, the new global debt crisis is our sort of priority at Jubilee Debt Campaign. It's been a priority campaign for a year, and it's probably going to be a priority for quite some time now. And if you really some of the background on what's happening and why we're concerned. So I guess the big picture that we welcome is a surprise which Anne and Bernard and Damon alluded to is one of high and rising global debt levels. International debt, so that's owed between countries, fell between 2008 and 2011, but they're on the increase again, rapidly. So total net debt between debtor countries, that's the debts that are owed by both public sector and private sector, so that's government debt, household debt, company debt, banking debt, which are not covered by corresponding assets, have risen from 11.3 trillion in 2011 up to 13.8 trillion in 2014, prediction is they'll be at 14.7 trillion by the end of this year. So in total, that's a 30% increase, 3.4 trillion in 4 years. And what's driving this is, it's mostly the major economies that are driving this. Eight out of 10 of the largest economies in the world have sought to recover from the Great Crash, the 2008 crash, by either borrowing or lending more, so further entrenching the imbalances in the global economy. This shows you the borrowers. We're one of them. The major borrowers who have sought to recover from the crash are the US, the UK, France, India and Italy. And this is both public debt and private debt, just to stress that. The lenders, the people who have recovered by lending more, are Germany, Japan and Russia. Now, we've been monitoring these figures, obviously, on an ongoing basis, but we did a big piece of research in July, which has been published, and you can get copies on the table just there, which tried to assess what the risks are, really, of these increasing debt levels and the potential impacts. We looked at the total net debt of countries, so both the public sector and the private sector. Also, there's quite a lot of data available on projected government payments, so the IMF and World Bank published lots of information. We don't necessarily agree with all of their predictions. They tend to be a bit rosy, a bit conservative, but they do look at what might happen to countries if there are economic shocks and other external impacts. And we also looked at the kind of ongoing sort of trading between countries and the rest of the world. And this is what we found. Secondly, we found rising and high global debt risks. So this table shows you the main findings of the research. So already around the world, there are 22 countries which are actually already in debt crisis, either a public sector debt crisis or a private sector debt crisis. There's a further 14 countries, particularly concentrated in sub-Saharan Africa and the small island states, which are plan approaching government debt crisis. They're at very high risk, but they're not quite there yet. There's 29 which are at risk, so the characteristics from the second column, I won't go into detail, but so you can understand what that means. We've got significant external public debt and significant projected future government debt payments. And crucially, 28 are at risk of a private sector debt crisis. This is what it looks like on a map. The red countries are already in public debt crisis, green are at risk, blue are high risk, and yellow are at risk of private sector debt crisis. If you look at the UK, you'll see that we're at yellow spot, which is at risk of private sector debt crisis. In parallel, in a different session, I think is the UK debt and austerity one at the moment, which is showing how the idea of that we have a public debt crisis in the UK is being used to justify austerity, but actually the real concerns in this country are around private sector debt, not public sector debt. There are some provisos here, so some of the countries will actually have multiple dots, so a yellow dot could be hiding also a blue dot and a green dot. And also there's a big, you'll have seen the iceberg we are also campaigning against the hidden debt iceberg of public-private partnerships, which is like off-balance sheet debt caused by semi-privatisation of public services and infrastructure. None of that is counted in any of this as well. So there's a whole other area of debt in the global economy they're concerned about which isn't reflected in these figures at the moment. How long have we got? So we're particularly concerned, obviously because we're concerned about the impact particularly of debt on the poorest people in the poorest countries. And as part of this, we're particularly worried about the lending boom that's happening to developing countries. So obviously we came out of the global response to the third world debt crisis, which led to two lost decades essentially of development for countries in Africa, Asia and Latin America. And we're really concerned that what we're seeing at the moment in terms of the scale of the boom in lending to developing countries is very parallel to the boom in lending that happened in the 1970s, which led to the global debt crisis. External loans to low-income countries, this is what's shown in this graph, have essentially tripled since the financial crisis. This is driven by lots of things, and we'll go into that a bit later. But particular things to flag are obviously the lack of lending regulation, the need for money, which Bernard will talk more about, the lack of regulation of lenders, so the sort of repeated bailing out of private sector lending when it happens, so that private sector lenders take no responsibility for the lending that they're doing. But also, interestingly, a key driver in this is the quantitative easing, which has happened in the UK and in Europe and in the US in response to the financial crisis. So governments have created lots of money, but that money hasn't found its way down into households in our countries. Mostly it's stayed with the finance sector, and the finance sector have invested it where they think they've got the best chance of a return on their profit, which is high-risk debt in developing countries. Added to this picture, which is this increasing number of debt crises and risk of them. We've got now what Anne was talking about, which is a global commodity price crash. So I guess in the last kind of few years, in the last decade, China's growth has kept commodity prices high with a bit of a blip a few years ago. But we've had economic stagnation elsewhere in the global economy. Now China's growth is also slowing down. It's primarily its demand for imports, so its raw material imports are reducing because it's rebalancing its economy as well. And this has led to a global commodity price crash, which has very severe and significant consequences for indebted countries, particularly developing countries. Direct means that countries are directly getting reduced income from imports. But they're also facing weakened currencies because of financial speculation against future reductions in import income, and as a result, reduced revenue for debt repayments. So basically, the relative size of countries' debts are increasing and their ability to repay them is decreasing. We, as part of our campaign, have done work bringing together essentially what we think is the global policy framework to avert future debt crises. They're going to come to that. Is it the end, or is it easy to talk about it now? I think it's good if we focus on the
problem. Let's come back to it.
So this is sort of part of the solution stuff. I think there's a lot more to hear than learning first about the problem before you get into that and do the second round. So that's the kind of backdrop.
Thanks very much, Sarah. Let's move straight on to Bernard talking through kind of perspective for that one.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Once again, getting the opportunity. I want to start off by saying that consider finding yourself in a very deep pond or a ditch filled with mud about twice your size, and you find yourself sinking even up to the chest level, and you realize that if you try digging yourself up, your weight makes you sink even quicker or faster. But if you want to wait on somebody coming to help you out, you're not sure when help is coming around. So you're sinking slowly, and it looks like the natural thing to do is what to try to help yourself out, because definitely you'll be in a panic situation. And I think that's the situation that Ghana is in now. It's a situation that you don't know whether you should stay still or should try to help yourself out. Because as I said earlier on, this is a country that just had debt relief. So you must as well know that it is not good to be indebted. In the sense that it constrains your ability to develop. As the saying always goes, when once beaten, you should be twice shy. But that wasn't to be the case for Ghana, because Ghana has no choice. Ghana has no choice because it has a very constrained fiscal space. You depend on a few export commodities as revenue for development. Your ability to raise tax revenue is very minimal. So if you have problems with these sources of financing, what do you need to do? You need to find another means. And unfortunately, Ghana has to go back to the capital markets for funding. And why so? Ghana has to do that because Ghana is basically a poor country giving a rich name. Giving a rich name meaning that you have no access to concessionary funding from the traditional donors such as your the multilateral institutions like World Bank, IMF, and bilateral institutions that will usually give you some concessionary funding. So it means that in a way dried up, which means that you need to fund your development or your other needs by going to the external market for loans, which are quite, in terms of the interest rates, are quite higher than what you would have expected. And I think that happened because along the line, when the IMF valued the Ghanaian economy, they thought, well, it was in a good stead to be able to pay its loans. And we know the IMF from history, and the World Bank from history, they have never done the best of analysis concerning most economies around the world. They have, like Sarah said earlier on, they have downplayed a lot of these potential problems. They will always not expect even shocks in terms of the global economic situation. they expect or they assume that your economy is growing as normal, is employing at full level, rates in terms of growth rates are quite high. That kind of assumption is very flawed, and that is why they have to think that Ghana do not need any concessionary funding and has to go to the market for exorbitant interest rate. So you realize that with this issue and the fact that global commodity prices dropped suddenly, it meant that Ghana had no means of other financing other than going to the capital markets. And tax revenues also reduced because currently Ghana is going through a problem of power crisis. Power crisis, that means that 24 hours your power is off. You only get power for about 6 hours. And sometimes you are not sure when the power comes on or comes off. So businesses are laying off workers every now and then. Medium and small scale businesses cannot just work because you can't turn up for work and there is no power to work. So how is the government even going to raise tax revenue for development? And the other thing is, if you look at the current interest rates, or the current interest rate obligations of the economy of Ghana, is about a third of revenues. So each time, in terms of government obligation to pay its interest to debt, is about a third of all the revenue that you get. And other statutory payment, like paying wages and salaries, is more than 50% of your revenues. And which means that you have less than a sixth of your revenues left for other development initiatives or other development projects. When you have your population growing at a rate of about 3% annually, so you have needs that you need to spend on, and yet you do not have any other means of spending other than going to the capital markets to borrow to spend. So with this kind of scenario, it means that Ghana will have to do something for itself, and doing something for itself meaning that you still have to go to the capital market to borrow. So we are going deeper and deeper into the debt situation. Our current debt level, according to the IMF signals, is about 70% or more of our GDP, and that is considered to be as a debt distress, I mean, level, which means that we are not credible borrowers. We borrow at high rates in the open market, and sometimes you don't even get it at all. Currently, the government of Ghana is looking out to borrow because it has no money in its kitty to pay workers or to finance other social programs. But the rates that it is getting from the open market is so exorbitant that it is holding back. Which means that a lot of development initiatives are being shelved and people are being suffering. So what is happening is, how does the government do this? The government had the IMF in town to come and help it do some of these things. So they have to raise up a lot of fees, revenues, and tariffs. Currently, as I speak, the government is on a roadshow trying to convince citizens that there is a need to increase electricity and water prices about 100%. So it is going back to the people to get more to finance any project. The people are resisting, because they only had increases in some of these tariffs not long ago. So the only way the government can do that is to go back and plead that, look, we need to increase these tariffs once more. So that is the kind of constraint on the Ghanaian economy. And that is the kind of constraint and the suffering that is put on the people. So you look at the situation, and not even the fact that we have this, but we came into a year with a kind of fiscal deficit about 9% of GDP. So you're already coming out from a hole. You're already deep in a hole. And all the revenues or your sources of revenue are not coming as you expect. So as a government who always want to look good in any sense, it has to push the burden to the citizens. And that is the situation that we're facing now. And which means that the debt crisis, as we are saying, it is real, a lot of people are suffering it. And it is not the situation that we are saying that it's going to abate. Because Ghana, as it is now, needs world commodity prices to rebound, to come up again, to be able to increase its sources of funding for its budget. But how long are these prices going to remain down? So if you have an economy that depends on a narrow stream of income for development, it is perpetually going to be under this problem of debt crisis. Because each time the global economic situation goes wrong, then you go with it. And that is the kind of situation that Ghana is facing now. So in terms of how people are going through this crisis, I want to give my own example. I used to buy a particular mosquito spray. You know, mosquito is quite a problem out there. And it used to cost me about 3.5 Ghana cedis. That's almost about a dollar. And with the kind of hardship and the kind of constraint on your disposable income, it means that you have to look for alternative consumption terms. You have to look for cheaper means of consuming your goods that you used to, you know. So I decided to switch off to a cheaper product. And for about 2 months, I was relying on this cheaper product. I decided to indulge myself once or after about 2 months to go back to my old product, which is a mosquito spray. And when I went to the supermarket to buy, it is now about 10 CD, 50 pesos, more than triple its price, just within 2 months. And that is how prices are escalating across board, almost everywhere, food prices and everything. So that is the kind of suffering that people are going through. And as I speak, I know a lot of people will be going back in terms of the gain that was made with the last Jubilee 2000 debt forgiveness. It's going to be rolled back again. A lot of people are getting back into poverty once more. And this is not a kind of situation that we should expect it to be going on and on. So we have to find a solution to it. So in terms of what do we need to do, I do think that it is about helping Ghana at this stage to be able to withstand the shocks for some time until the global economy reverses or things get better. And helping Ghana to get by means that we still need the concessionary loans or funding for our economy. Because even as we try to go to the open market, we are not getting any better rate. So we still need the concessionary funding. That's the only way that can perhaps down our risk into debt crisis. We are already in a debt crisis, but getting into a stage that is difficult to get back means that we still need a domestic or the international bodies to give us more of concessionary funding to be able to get by. And the other issue in terms of the long-term way to get out of this is that if you look in terms of what Ghana loses, or in terms of what African countries loses in terms of revenues to the rest of the world, a lot of researches have been done. And the figure that we have, there are various figures, but we know that African countries are losing close to $50 billion a year through illicit financial flows. These are monies not recorded, so they cannot be taxed anyway. So it's possible to retain this money in Africa if we are able to arrest this illicit financial flows. A study that we did with Ghana specifically over the last, between 2003 and 2012, Ghana lost close to $8 billion just through trade between the EU and US. That is just trade. We're not talking of other issues, but just trade across the borders. Either products coming from Ghana to the EU or the US, they are either overpriced, and those that we are importing, they are underpriced. And this is a research that we conducted. So it's possible to be able to retain a lot of this money within our economies if we are able to arrest this illicit financial flows issues. And it is all part of the financialization problem. So these processes can be looked at in detail and to see how to stem our situation. Otherwise, only rely on a narrow range of exports for revenue for development is never the long term going to be the solution, because the global arena is very prone to so much like the boom and bust is becoming so frequent. And what would have done for Ghana in our situation was if we had a more stable global system that you can project in the long term and say, well, you are growing at this rate and this is how your economy can withstand some of the shocks over the long time. But we do not get that. The boom and bust is so frequent these days, and we cannot control the global economic situation. The only thing that we can control is how do our domestic production system allow us to retain a lot of the income from the resources that we are exploiting? How does that allow us to retain a lot of the income that we are exploiting? So that when times like this come round, then the economy is able to withstand the shocks for a while before the good times come round again. Otherwise, we are going to be in this cycle of debt crisis. So the situation, as I gave concerning Ghana, is real, especially if you look at the debt relief. It was able to have poverty in Ghana from a rate of about 52% to about 27% between 2000 and 2007 and 2008 thereabout. At that point, I think between that period, Ghana probably had the longest period of economic peace. There was a kind of renewed hope that things were going to get better, in the sense that government had that leverage to be able to spend, because most of the debt that we would have paid was being pushed into poverty alleviation programs. So a lot of strain was taken off government. So it was possible for government to invest in infrastructure in other areas, and it was possible for us to have that economic peace for for citizens to look ahead and know that, look, things are getting better and they are going to get better. And the economy was growing consistently. Only for this whole thing to be turned around again. And it's also happened because even though Ghana cocoa and gold used to be our major primary exports, and world market prices for this product had fallen for a very long time, but because we had oil, we were able to coast along for a while. It was possible to ride on that because we were getting up to about $1 billion or $1.5 billion from oil revenues. So it did not look that bad until the oil prices plummeted. Then all of a sudden, it looked like we are in hell. So why should our destiny be on just one commodity or the fact that anything can happen the next minute? So the other issue that I think that we could do is because our economy has not been designed such a way that it supports the domestic production system such a way that helps the people, in terms of the human resource, to be able to accumulate some savings. So in terms of the Ghanaian people, or most people in sub-Saharan Africa, they have no savings to turn back onto when these difficult times come. And all the savings that are usually done is done at the national or the state level. So when the state has a problem, then everybody have a problem. So how do we re-engineer the production system such a way that a lot more people get jobs, such a way that they are able to work and accumulate some surpluses for themselves, to the point that when these problems comes, people are able to get by and not to get into the bondage of poverty? And that is what is happening now. And we think that it's because we followed both the IMF and the World Bank prescription in the 80s and the mid-80s. It opened our economies up to the point that we were no longer competitive in any way. What happened was that our manufacturing sector just dropped down. Currently, I'm not sure what is produced in Ghana anymore, apart from the primary commodities. When it comes to agriculture, it's going down and down. So you go to the streets of Accra or the streets of Ghana, what the young people, everyone is doing around is selling products, very cheap products, made from China, Dubai, or other parts of the world. That is what people are selling around. Our economy is now selling other people's products. It is not the kind of sustainable economic system that you want to have, because it can just vanish at any distance, because most of what they do is not so sustainable, in the sense that you sell just a few products and your returns on that product is not that much. It's just to keep you up. So a lot of this problem has built up over the years, up to the extent that we are no more in a position to be able to absorb some of the shocks that are becoming so frequent this time. So in my conclusion, I'll say that we think that the world has to come to our aid once more, if not to forgive us our debt, but at least to consider giving us more of the concessionary funding that can sustain us until the world market prices or commodity prices rebound. Otherwise, we are still sinking and sinking in that pit of mud. Thank you, and thank you very much for your time.
Great, thanks very, very much, Bernard. Welcome to Hopi. You really set out, I think, the difficulties that Ghana's faced, both in terms of having its manufacturing base eviscerated during the 80s and 90s under IMF prescriptions, to then be dependent upon a few commodities, and then to the difficulty that that faces in terms of how do you invest in the development that's needed to ensure that we get that progress. And you know, the fact that where there was deficit in forgiveness, poverty could be harmed, I think, shows that what we're asking for, what we're aiming for, is not beyond reach, it's not beyond the possibilities. The figure that came to my mind was partly in Sarah's presentation, where the global public debt being set at $15.5 trillion and the need for investment in Ghana. I was reminded of a tax justice network figure which calculated that the assets held within tax havens globally being put at between $21 and $32 trillion. And the question I ask myself is, how do we create a financial system where all of that wealth goes to places like Ghana, where it can actually be used to increase human well-being? So with that kind of question, I'll pass on to Sarah to talk around some of the global policy framework.
Thanks. Here again. Just very briefly. So I think what was really clear from what Bernard was saying is that we are kind of back really where we started in some way, post the wins of the Jubilee 2000 movement, and we're seeing a lot of the same processes happening again. Already, lots of countries, countries that like Jamaica, which didn't even get debt cancellation, have been facing this for the last 20 years, but countries that did get debt cancellation, back in the situation of high and unsustainable debts, having to go to the World Bank and the IMF to ask for more bailout loans, and then being subject to the horrendous austerity requirements of the World Bank and IMF loans, which lead to further economic stagnation, public sector wage cuts, public sector job losses, increasing poverty, increasing inequality, and further undermining the ability of countries to repay their debts. And then on top of that, there's the global currency price crash as well. What it shows to us is that while debt cancellation was really important and gave some really essential breathing space for developing countries after it was achieved, that we needed to go further, and we need to go further now in terms of tackling the extraction of wealth which is happening on an ongoing basis from countries so that they stop getting into such heavy debts in the first place. And we've done some work on sort of bringing together what that kind of policy framework to allow that to happen. A lot of the thinking is already out there in the global economic justice movement. Particularly campaigners in the global south have been talking for decades around tax justice, cracking down on the extraction of profit by the extractive industry, all of this. And it doesn't need a lot more thinking in terms of solutions. It needs a strong global movement to actually push for those solutions. This is our thinking, just in summary of what it needs to include. So first of all, we need to regulate the banks and international financial flows. So what we've seen since the 1970s has been the increasing deregulation of the finance sector. Starting in the 1970s, the lifting of regulations in the US, in Europe, basically allowing banks to lend whatever they want, no matter what the consequences. And that packaged together with the bailing out of the private sector again and again and again, which gives the message that irresponsible lending is absolutely fine. The private sector won't lose out from not taking responsibility for that. We also think we need, as well as ensuring more of a balance between lenders' responsibility and responsibility of borrowing countries, you do need a kind of international bankruptcy process for countries. There's lots of technical words for how it's being described, but some sort of arbitration mechanism or debt workout mechanism agreed internationally. We have seen some really exciting progress actually in achieving that recently in the United Nations. Argentina, which has been subject to pillaging by vulture funds since its debt crises, has been pushing for this in the UN. And over the last year, we've seen lots of progress and lots of consensus in the United Nations. And the UN General Assembly agreed a set of principles just recently this September basically, there are only principles at the moment that to guide sovereign debt restructuring. So that when countries like Ghana face debt crises, they don't. How those crises are resolved is not decided by the lenders, the rich countries, or the people with the wealth and the power. There is a fair and transparent process which has gone through, like happens in this country for bankruptcy of businesses, to actually say, can the debts be repaid? How much is owed, whose responsibility is this debt, this kind of thing. Unfortunately, the UK was one of the countries to consistently vote against these principles as they went through the UN General Assembly process. That really shows the degree to which our government acts internationally in the interests of the finance sector and the global financial elite, rather in the interests of poor people and justice and ordinary working people. We do think we need more debt cancellation. We do need, as Damon and Anne alluded to in the beginning session, we do need to level the playing field again. The burden of debt on some countries is phenomenal and is eating into the basic ability of states to perform their basic functions, to provide hospitals, to provide schools, to provide welfare, and that is just fundamentally unjust. And the only way that we're going to actually get to be able to start to on a fresh footing is by another round of debt cancellation. We think that's critical. But we think we need to go beyond that. And we actually need, as Bernd said, tax justice. We need to, first of all, stop the tax dodging by multinational companies and by wealthy individuals, which are sucking trillions of pounds, trillions of dollars of money out of spending countries all the time. And on that basis, it will allow countries to actually have decent domestic resource mobilisation to actually keep money in countries, be able to pay for services and pay for state functions, as opposed to having to borrow for it. We think we need to tackle the new hidden sources of public debt, so public-private partnerships, and we've got a session in here on that. Support responsible lending and borrowing. And also stop the push for aid to take the form of grants, stop the push for aid in the form of loans. There's a very insidious push from donor governments to, rather than give development aid to countries where it's urgently needed, to give that in the form of loans, which we think is actually contributing to debt, further contributing to debt crises. Those are the kind of changes which we think are needed, but obviously, fundamentally, it's about tackling the imbalances of wealth and power in the global economy, which is how it ties really into the bigger struggle for justice for developing countries and reparations for colonialism and the injustices that has caused. And I think Mr. Coffey's brilliantly arrived perfectly in time to talk to you about that.
Thanks to Jubilee Debt Campaign for inviting me to share views that are not really my own, you know, views that are quite widespread within the activist sections of our African heritage communities, including those that are here, on the debt crisis. Now, the direct question is what can be done to end this cycle? Because now we see clearly from all that has happened, particularly from 2000, with all that went into the Jubilee 2000 campaign, and the, you know, modest gains that were made by that campaign, amongst them, you know, raising of consciousness globally about the fact that this is a problem, you know, not just for people in Africa and other parts of the global south, but also for people here. And that was one of the tremendous gains of the Jubilee 2000 campaign. You know, a massive movement, you know, of all kinds of people all over the world connecting to work on this issue. And then come the folding down of the campaign, you know, in a few years, you know, we've seen this building up again. And the problem, you know, has become, you know, quite stuck in the face of all of us, you know, and we see it manifesting itself, particularly here in Europe, you know, in terms of the crisis and you know, the things that all the, you know, on the back of austerity, really. So clearly, this is not going to go away. And it's not something that we can be throwing energies at, you know, haphazardly, you know, which doesn't yield the results commensurate with the kinds of energies that are poured, you know, into campaigning on this issue. So we've got to begin to look at the root causes. And this is very, very buried in history. And sometimes when we talk about the debt crisis, immediately people talk about, you know, Africa, you know, South America, Asia, and so on. But the point is, the process started from here. And you really have to critically look at what Britain and Europe has been. And the attempt by certain sections of this society to hide behind austerity, to claw back gains that have been made in lifting the standard of living of people in Europe should compel us to look at historical root causes. Simply put, from our perspective, it's going back to those times of the privatization of the commons. Because people forget that there was a time when, you know, a lot of resources were in the common ownership of societies. But then, as a particular kind of ruling class began to emerge in these societies, it decided to take what was common, in common ownership, into its use. And it did it fouling. Now, having succeeded in violently dispossessing the majority of people, you know, in Europe, and making them now work to death to enrich them first and foremost, he decided to globalize this process. Globalization is not a very recent thing. It's been, you know, around for quite some time. And that is in that process of the globalization of a system of expropriating resources from common ownership here in Europe, this ruling class took that to places like Africa, the Americas, you know, Asia, where we call the global south. And that is really what we must begin to understand. So what has happened in Africa? Of course, it's not exactly the same process, because what we have in Africa particularly, it included chattelization of our people, when, you know, our people were regarded not as human beings, as subhuman, with all kinds of arguments made not in the slums and ghettos, you know, of this country, but in the high institutions of the Oxbridge. You know, and Peter Fry in Staying Power, The History of Black People in Britain, goes into, you know, that thing of pseudo-scientific racism. The educational institutions, the high educational institutions in this country were part of fabricating means to justify this process here in this country as well as across the world. And the fundamental element in justifying across the world was to then use racism to bring people who ought to be in solidarity and had been forging solidarity with in those being colonized, a significant section were won over, you know, with this thing that, oh, we are superior race. We need to own the world. The rest of the world is inhabited by savages. So it is our civilizing mission, our historic mission to civilize them in that process, you know, dehumanizing them, was justified. And a good number of people went along with that. Not everybody in this country. And that is also a history that is not well known even in this country, that ordinary people who were not, you know, who didn't have the privilege to be in the Oxbridge institutions, to be in the centers of learning of these ruling classes, saw through this life and fought it every step along the way. That is not the history that is taught here. That is not the history of Europe that is taught across the world. So what, when it comes to Africa, we see a situation where people were won over, but these are not human beings, so anything can be done to them to justify the process of taking their homelands away. And worse, using their labor to generate more wealth and then taking control of the fruits of their labor, right? And that was a colonization of peoples across the world, was their process of pulling them into a debt trap. How? We take away your lands, we impose ourselves, you know, on you in your own land. We say you're not human beings, we need to be there to do God's work of civilizing you. By the cost of that, you pay for it. And some of the immediate acts of rebellion against colonization were in the tax rebellions. And they are dotted all over, you know, history of Africa, where ordinary people couldn't understand why you take our lands, you invite yourselves to rule us, and then we have to pay for it. And women were foremost in many of the tax rebellions across, you know, Africa. Right? So the process, as Thomas Sankara, to cut a long story short, as Thomas Sankara well explains this, and it's on video, you can see, it's all rooted, our indebtedness is rooted, so-called indebtedness is rooted in the history of colonization, and it hasn't changed since. So we take your resources, we impose ourselves as your rulers, you pay for it, and we create a system whereby we take your resources to enrich a few in Europe, use racism to get the majority of you people in Europe to come along with it and to accept it, right? And then we continue improving that system of indebtedness so that even when, you know, you compel us to physically, you know, relinquish direct rule of you, we maintain the system so intact that the indebtedness continues. So virtually all the time, all of them, at the proclamation of independence in Africa, that's when the indebtedness started. Because you, like the French did to Haiti, even for your freedom, you've got to pay for it. And how do you pay for it? Because we impose a particular mode of development on you. And any departure from that mode is treason. And any of your leaders who comes with any programs of development that is not what we have ordained you to follow, then we will remove them and we will kill them, right? To teach you a lesson that you can depart from this path of maldevelopment that keeps you indebted, you know, to us. And this is why the cycle is there. I really want you to understand. The cycle continues to be imposed bloodily upon the majority of peoples of the world, right? And you're now seeing the first signs of it in the imposition of austerity, right? That is why there is more, you know, information about here. In Africa, you are just violently repressed. Why is it that in Africa now we have a growing movement for the decolonization of educational institutions and societies? Because still it is criminal, literally, and unacceptable that even in our academic institutions, there are relics of Euro, what we say, Eurocentric colonial education, right? These are not things that you are even allowed to explore, even if you wanted to do so, you know, on your own, right? So collaboration in education is very important. We we have a lot more material that you produce to try to educate people here. We need those kinds of materials, you know, so that our young people, particularly in schools, colleges, and universities, can see the legitimacy of intellectually questioning this order, right? And then lend that legitimacy to the resistance of their communities against further expropriation and the big lies that are peddled, particularly around PPPs, PFIs, and so on, that, you know, your governments are helping our governments, you know, to impose, you know, upon people. It's all a fabrication. It's all a bunch of big lies, right? And people are not allowed in our parts of us to even intellectually question them. And it's a cynicism why education is important in this battle in terms of things we can do together, you know, is that right now, even at our educational institutions, particularly, you know, yeah, education at every level is under threat. Because with neoliberalism, we have opened the doors for now, you know, Western educational institutions to establish themselves in our parts of the world. So that's number what I would like to emphasize in terms of things we can do together. Secondly, we ought to also support the alternatives that people are trying to develop, you know, in terms of alternative economic projects, in terms of, you know, alternative lifestyles away from consumerism. The sickening thing about the African elite, the Eurocentric African elite, is that you just want to ape their smarts in everything, you know, and wastefulness is very much part of it. Living simply in harmony with nature, which is our traditional African way of life, is again seen as being primitive. So that is the reality. You can ask if the reality is that once people have, school children have passed through even secondary school in Ghana, they think that it is not cool to touch the soil. It's not cool to go to farm with your parents. It's not cool to be growing your own food, right? And it's cool to be wearing anything that appears in the shops of Europe, particularly when they are sent as secondhand goods. So these are some of the things, the alternatives that have been developed here, you know, are important for us to collaborate, you know, around. And there is more, but basically these are some of the things. And that would lead to a point where through these linkages, we now connect our struggles from the grassroots and wage them ground up globally. And once that power can be flexed in a way where the anti-austerity movement, the anti-debt movement in Europe is part and parcel of the same global social movement that exists in Africa, exists in Asia, exists in Americas, just that very flexing of a united global might of the 99% may scare the 1% enough, you know, to move away, you know, move out of our way in building a new world, a debt-free world. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Kofi. We do have a bit of time for questions and short comments. I'm going to kind of run around. Is that all working now?
Yes.
You
might need to.
So if we take a few questions, could you like to raise that hand?
Do you want me to stand or shall I stand and look? Hello, yeah. I'm Bruce Nixon. I found your powerful speech really inspiring. Brilliant. Thank you so much, and that's all the contributions. I'm going to offer what I think is a practical solution, one out of many, because it's all an interrelated, complex system. I love what you said about education. I'm a member of the Positive Money Organization. I don't know how many of you have heard of it. Can you tell me if you've heard of it?
Yeah.
Not a majority. I think this is a very important contribution. At the moment, as probably you know, 90% of our money is created by banks. That is totally absurd, it's undemocratic, and of course their interest is in creating debt in so doing and making money out of it. Now, that's one thing I think we can oppose, positive money. The other second thing is, there's something about sovereign money. I'm so glad to hear Jeremy Corbyn is advised properly. He talks about people's QE. I've yet to sort of find out more about that. But positive money talks about sovereign money. Instead of QE, which I think normally goes to the banks, what needs to be done, as the New Economics Foundation has proposed, is to send the money direct to such things as building infrastructure, and that's schools, hospitals. So there's absolutely no need to create debt by creating infrastructure. I'd just like to give you, this is very naughty of me, about a plug for my book, which is called The 21st Century Revolution, and borrowing from Polly Higgins, A Call to Greatness, because we all need to be great and, you know, campaign and do everything we can. So that's my contribution to the debate. Thank you very much indeed. I hope it didn't take too long.
My name's Judith Bum-Kofi. Way back in 2000, your passions kept us going, and I remember with gratitude. How do you keep going? Because it's outrage. People can think it's anger, but how does one, I don't know, because, yes, how do you cope with people's fears? We are a fearful country now, we are a fearful country. How do you say you'll be stronger and you will find strength? Because it is finding strength, and we look to you, and I agree with you, communication and education, but I mean, our media makes it very, I come here today because I know that the facts, the groundwork, the quiet keeping going of Jubilee 2000 through these down years, it's solid, it's fact, and you don't get it much in the media unless you read certain parts of it. And I just, how do we keep going through difficult times, and where do you find your strength? And how can you, what am I saying, cope with fear?
Thanks. My name is Paulio Bransky. I'd like to pick up on the question of commodity prices. I think it's important to see commodity prices as not an inevitable feature of the world market, but a political struggle. And it's a struggle of the power relations between producers and consumers, and between buyers and sellers. And I think that it's a struggle that's quite likely to become quite important global level again in the near future, just as it was in the 70s when there was a struggle to create a new international economic order and the question of commodity cartels. So I was wondering, to what extent in Ghana is there actually a struggle over political pricing? I mean, obviously it's a struggle that can't be waged by one country alone, it's clearly a global conflict, but what is Ghana doing at the international level about struggling for political pricing? Thanks.
Hello, Peter Merson, trustee of Jubilee Debt Campaign and chair of its somewhat lapsed multi-faith project, which I was talking to Sanji, who sat next to me this morning and said it's about time we got it going again. And actually, particularly what Kofi has said, everything that you have said is really true of what most of the major faiths of the world have been saying for generations through history. And I think for a time we had it as, it certainly was one of the things that has inspired Jubilee Debt Campaign or Jubilee 2000 in the first place. And I think perhaps it's time to reawaken the major faith communities who are already saying this sort of thing individually, and maybe we need to work together. And the problem that I have is the turning the belief into the activism, and I think that's where we struggled a year or two ago, and I think somehow we need to re-energize that and get people to express the outrage that you've expressed so well within our faith communities. And we should not be cozying up to power, we should be actually speaking prophetically to power from whatever faith base or none that we have, and we actually do need to really work on this and say that the common good is so important, it's the overriding importance. We share a common humanity and planet and all the rest of it, and finance needs bringing under control.
I agree with all that I've heard today, but don't you really think that underlying the problem of debt is actually capitalism? And it's really politics, it's capitalism that we should be addressing here. And it's really system change. Because what we're talking about is finance capitalism. It's the next stage in the development. And it's that which is oppressing people in Africa, across the world, and in this country now, as you rightly say, with austerity and the austerity which is being spread through Europe, and which will replicate the oppression which we've seen over the past 100, 200 years in countries in Africa and Asia.
I think we're running out of time, really, if we're going to have lunch at 12:30. So we've had a few kind of practical proposals about how to ensure that there's control over financing. There's this question about this political struggle over commodities, and there's this kind of question around that, where does our faith come from, where does our values come from in terms of continuing the struggle, and this kind of political question about, is it the control of capital that we're after, or what is that kind of system change type of struggle? Do these practical kind of policy answers add up to enough in some senses? So I'll ask, starting on my left perhaps, and moving right, the three different speakers to respond to those kind of different issues, or pick out which ones you want to.
Right, thank you very much. I'll respond to the political struggle for commodity pricing. I would like to pick off from where Kofi left off in terms of the political elites in Africa and the global south, I think, have been compromised to the extent that this is no more their battle areas. When the IMF and the World Bank led the liberalization of our economies and sought to bring about competitiveness and other things, and led to the selling of government and other state enterprises to the private sector, what was left was most of these factories were left to become warehouses for imports. And these same political elites have gone very much into trading of some of these commodities. So they are no more interested so much about how it affects the country, but they are very much in league with their counterpart capitalist people in other parts of the world to fleece the people. So that is no more a struggle. You do not hear any government or people talking about the fact that commodity prices are as a result of a structural system that has been created over the years. They take it as an expected situation, a consequential situation that is expected, and all that they got to do is deal with it. It is only campaigns like this Jubilee campaign and other campaigns that drill a bit more deeper about the causes of some of these problems. But at the political level or at the government level, it is no more a discussion, because the very people who are supposed to lead this discussion are now part of the system. They are now profiting from this system. They owe some of them. They are all part of the global system who are trading in these commodities left, center, and right. So they do not have an interest in trying to say that, look, it is a structural system, a structural problem that has to be looked at politically and that has to be corrected. They have become part of the system that perpetrates some of these things. So that kind of struggle is out of it altogether. It is left to struggles like the Jubilee campaign and other global campaigns from civil society and NGOs and like-minded who have to now take up some of these campaigns and try to revert back into the root causes of some of this. So my simple answer is that it is no more there. That struggle is no more talked about, because the same political elites in the global south have become part of the problem. Thank you.
Thanks. I'll just talk very quickly to the positive money point. So positive money are one of our allied organisations in the UK Economic Justice Movement, and we really appreciate the work that they're doing to shine a spotlight on the banking system. We don't totally agree actually with their solutions. We're not totally against debt actually, as you view that campaign. We think it can actually serve a useful purpose sometimes, and we think that some of their solutions in terms of how you totally remove debt from the economy are not workable. We also think some of their solutions don't actually address the fundamental problems around power and capture of the institutions of the state by the kind of financial agenda. So I think part of the positive money proposal in terms of how money creation would be regulated would be through a parliamentary committee. And we think that unless you kind of tackle the fundamental kind of power imbalances and the influence that the finance sector has, we'd still probably be seeing the same kind of problems there. We definitely really appreciate the work that they're doing, and the quantitative easing campaign that you mentioned, I think is a really good kind of short-term thing to actually boost the sort of stagnating problem that we're facing in the UK economy at the moment. I just want to talk to you also the question of, is it capitalism or not? I think what we really want to do in our work as JDC over the next few years, and particularly this day, is talk about what we can do together. And I think fundamentally, whether it's capitalism or finance capitalism or the debt system, we kind of what we need to do is the same thing. And that's why what Kofi was talking about was so important, that it's really about education and empowerment, connecting up with struggle. So for too long, the kind of global justice aspect of the movement is in the country has been separated from the UK social justice parts of the movement. So the Labour Assembly Against Austerity is meeting in down the road. There's a housing meeting down the road. Today is the day where the kind of UK progressives are really showing quite how, in a way, how uncoordinated we are. And it's fantastic to be talking and meeting around these issues, but actually to win on this stuff and to make real headway, we need to be much more coordinated and joined up and have wider platforms that go beyond just debt or debt in the global south or debt in the UK. And we want to go beyond that and start to mobilise again. So we talk a lot in the office about the G8 demonstration, and probably quite a few people were here when Jubilee 2000 and others organised 70,000 people to surround the G8. And we do believe that it's that scale of mobilisation and escalation that we actually need to reassert the kind of power of the global justice movement in this country, and that whether you're attacking capitalism or something else, that pathway is very clear, and we feel that we need to kind of concentrate on actually like building that strength, that solidarity between activists in this country.
I entirely agree with that approach on that question, because what is important is not to be dictating to people that you must see it as this. What we want is to create, connections between our diverse struggles so that we can, whatever people see as a problem, so long as it is channeled towards tackling the root cause, that is what is, important. I certainly recognize that as capitalism. But of course, the indigenous communities who have to battle against it first and foremost see it as, trying to disconnect them from Mother Earth, disconnect them from, the harmony that they've been trying to establish with nature. And it's no use trying to impose, upon them as the starting point, of action. That see it as this, and it is that kind of network we need to create, globally. And somewhere along the, you see, our campaigns ought to be action learning campaigns, shared learning campaigns. In that process, through dialogue, we raise each other's understanding. We are actually increasing the common grounds, from which, we wage struggle. But if we are waiting, as some people do, I want to have clarity from you, in terms of how I see it, before we connect, I think it's just going to play into the kind of divisions, that have been exploited up to now. The question about fear is really what I want to, you know, deal with. It is real. And you'll be stupid to think that you just get up and, you know, go gung-ho, you know, against a very well established, you know, armed minority. That does not hesitate to spill blood to maintain a system. It is fear. But the challenge we face is that posed by, you know, one of my favorite, you know, activists, Huey P. Newton, you know, of the Black Panther Party. His book is written on that, you know, revolutionary suicide. You know, will you let fear, you know, will you let fear take you to the point of becoming so petrified that you, the result is you're not active about it until it eliminates you anyway, right? Or will you let that fear galvanize you into action to the point where you lose that fear completely? That is the challenge, right? And, you know, if we want to see what inaction can do, let us think for a moment about if the kinds of, you know, even uncoordinated, you know, resistance being put up were to disappear, everybody cowed in silence and inaction, what the system is capable of doing. You know, because it sees, it always wants to dehumanize people to the point that particularly its victims are seen as non-human. Okay? And you will be not a human being if you tolerate what the system is doing, you know, globally. So it is our very, we need to draw strength from the necessity to uphold our humanity against what this inhumane system represents. And that for me is my greatest spur into action. Because no matter what the fears are, and each day we're losing our colleagues, our counterparts, in those parts of the world where even to speak would cost you your life. Many, many parts of the world still are like that. But when you think of the fact that at least speaking isn't going to cost you your life here, then you take on more responsibility, you know, and that leads to the point where, you know, literally, you, because you act together with those people in places where they are not, and doing things which they would like to do that you cannot do, then that fear actually, you know, strengthens you, you know, to the point where you lose it completely. But the most important thing of all is for us to connect and to be there for each other and to know that even if at some place in the world, you know, if in some moment you look so alone, so isolated, with all the doubts that come, there are human beings somewhere on this planet who are together with you. We as Africans, we talk about, you know, and Cabral said this, you know, our greatest writer said, we are societies not just of the living, but also of the dead and those yet to come. And if you see it that way, then the historical wrongs for which people have fought and died, that you will have some kind of life today, must be foremost in your mind to take responsibility for what you have to do today, but also mindful of the fact that the lives that are going to come, including those you bring about, you dare not leave them with a world worse than you found. And you ought to leave some imprint, some footprint, which they can can trace and say, yes, no matter how you ended your life, you lived simply as a human being. Enough for me to face up to whatever there is and also do nothing other than strive to be simply human. Because we sometimes lose sight of the fact that when we stand up for these things, all we are asking for is to be human, to be respected